we have seen that in the short run, the competitive firm should continue to produce, even if it's losing money, as long as it can pay its workers. That is, it should produce as long as the price it receives is greater than the typical bearable cost for a unit. And then in the long run, all inputs are bearable, and the firm should shut down if it's not able to further all of those bearable costs on average. In either case, in the short run or the long run, the firm should produce up to the point where the price equals the cost of producing one more unit. So we assume that marginal cost is rising, and therefore the cost of prior units of production are much lower than the price, yielding a profit. So here's an example of the Carina's bicycle shop. Carina may not know it, but she repairs bicycles. Here is the average total cost curve for Korea. In other words, this curve is showing the cost of repairing the typical bicycle. I'll just call it ETC. And now let's add a typical representative cost per variable inputs, looks like that. One more try. So this curve shows not all costs, but just variable costs, such as the cost of labor of producing a typical bicycle for Carina. Now I will add marginal cost. But no, I think we're in business. So Carina makes her decisions based on the price in her market. The price she has no influence over, the picks as given. So let's say that the first occurs right here for now. Being a good prophet maximizer, Trevina produces up to the point that the price is equal to marginal cost. Right there at point A. So she produces paid one bikes. A question for you, is Kavita making a profit at that level of production in the short run? Is she making a profit? Well, notice that at pivot one, the price exceeds average total cost. And so she is making money on each typical bike that she prepares. People say that she's making economic profits. Which just means that Trevina is making more money than would be typical in other industries. So here is her average variable cost. That's her average total cost. And her profits consist of the shaded area here, that is the difference between the price that she receives and the amount that she must pay to repair a typical bike. So profit, economic profit, are equal to the difference between price and average total cost times the level of production. So, for example, suppose that Kavita charging 10,000 tickets to repair each bike, and that her cost of doing so was 8,000 tickets. But she pays to workers and also to the bank for her loan. She has been paying 10 bucks per day. So her profits are 2,000 pay plus over average total cost times 10 bucks or 50,000 pay per day. Sounds like a nice business to be in, Karina. Maybe I will try it. Now, we've already seen that Kavita should remain in business only if the price is high enough to cover average variable cost, even at its lowest level. So in this graph, average variable cost is minimized by here. If the price ever falls beneath that minimum, Karina should shut down even in the short run because she can no longer pay her workers. So here is the demand curve. The Karina. She will produce as long as she can cover variable costs for the typical bite, and then she will maximize profits by producing at the plate to the plate equals marginal cost. So this is a two-step procedure. First, set that your melted price is higher than average variable cost, even at its minimum. Second, if you satisfy the condition, produce up to a point that price equals marginal cost. And you can see the reason for the rule in the graph. When Karina is producing the level paid one, she is making profit on each and every bike. Here's the price, and then here's the average total cost down here. But more to the point, she's also making money on each additional bike. That is, the price that she receives for one more bike exceeds the cost of repairing it. So we can think of operating profits and think about the profits of the reserve for Kavita as the difference between the price and average total cost times the number of bikes that she is producing. However, she just follows the very simple rule that she should repair one more bike as long as she can make enough money to cover the cost of the one additional bike. She makes a decision about that the bike, and then when she reaches a point where she is no longer making money on the additional big superstar. There is a level of production. Not here. Call this day two. The frontier, her price does not cover her additional cost of production. Right there, you can see that the price is below of the cost of producing one more bike. So, for example, suppose that for the additional bike, the marginal cost of producing it is 12,000 pages. Should she repair that bike? The answer is no, because the price that she would receive is only 10,000 tenge. She would lose money on that bike, so she should not produce it. Now, notice that even though that additional bike is unprofitable, still overall, Kalina is making money. At this level, the price is still above average total cost. However, if she chooses to produce at that level, although she will profit, she will not profit as much as she could had she simply stopped producing at the point that the money received from one board by just barely covers the cost of repairing it. And that's the intuition behind why Kalina will become a millionaire by repairing bikes. Any questions about that model? Okay, good. So those results are from the fully competitive firm. That is, a firm that is so small when compared to the industry that depend on the price on its own, it will have to take the market price as given. And now, let's take a look at the case of a monopoly. That is one firm that dominates the market. Because the monopoly does not have to worry about price competition with other producers. It is free to set the highest price that it can for its level of production. the monopoly follows a three-step procedure. First, the teller is bringing a grocery store. Then people first determine how many liters of milk that he should provide. He should sell up to the point that the margin of revenue is equal to marginal cost. Note that this is the same rule as for the competitive firm. It is just the case that for the competitive firm, marginal revenue was the price. Second, since he cannot is free to set the price wherever he wants, he should set the highest price that the market can bear for the amount of food that he is going to sell. And then finally, calculate profits by computing revenue, money received, minus the cost of that level of production. So here is Dipenlot's problem. Dipenlot is the only producer in Almaty of avocado sandwiches. Avocado sandwiches are very good. And then that is over here. Here is different demand function. And then, as we already know, Dipenlot's marginal revenue function has the same intercept as the input demand function and has a slope that is twice as steep. So there is marginal revenue. And then, for simplicity, let us assume that marginal cost is constant, although that is not a necessary assumption. Okay, so Dipenlot will produce under the terms that as long as the money that he is making on the terms, that additional terms, marginal revenue, is able to cover the cost of producing the terms. So all along the horizontal axis, all of these terms are worth producing because the revenue exceeds the cost of the festival sandwich. And so we reach the profit maximizing scale of production, 0.8. So this is called the point of S1. S for super temperatures. Second, infinite, let's define the price to charge to each sandwich. And since he is interested in making as much money as possible, he will set the highest price that the market will bear. That high price is given by the inverse demand function. So, for example, suppose that you do not, this is a cost of 100 tenge for another service. At this level of production, the highest price that you do not charge is 300 tenge. So he is making money on each and every service that he produces. These are economic problems. That is, Dutton is making more money in this industry than he would in any other typical industry. And then, finally, you can calculate profits. The difference between total revenue and total cost. So let's take a look at an example of how to calculate profits given specific information about the market. Any question about why you cannot is maximizing profits at point A. Note, by the way, that this level of production is well below the level that would prevail in a competitive firm or a competitive industry. had this or not been in a competitive industry, he would have been forced, in a sense, to produce as two sandwiches altogether at a price that equals marginal cost. But this is a competitive industry in which the marginal business function is not here, but instead is equal to the price line. Okay, here's a puzzle for you to try now at the side of extra credits. You are running a pharmaceutical company. You have a patent on a vaccine against a new variant of the coronavirus. Here's your inverse demand function. Also, marginal cost is pretty simple. It costs just $1 to produce one more dose of the vaccine. So the first thing for you is to determine what level of production that you want to undertake and what price you will charge for that level. And then finally, calculate the profit as well. Now, note one thing about the inverse demand function. It is that this is an offer because the coefficient on quantity involves 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 2, not an easy number to turn you around mentally when you're making calculations. So what I suggest is that you, in your calculations, use scientific notation. So this proposition is the same as 2 out of 100,000. Or 2 × 10⁻⁵. Here are some other examples. 20 is equal to 2 × 10⁻¹. Since scientific notation is keeping track of the number of spaces between the base and the decimal point. For example, 200.0 is the same as 2 × 10⁻², because there are 2 zeros, 2 places before the decimal point. Then here are some exercises that you can try right now for 1 point of extra credit.
Professor, excuse me.
Yes, go ahead.
What about the problem about the profit maximization for monopoly? Will we talk about it for, will we solve the profit yes. maximization level for extra credit?
Yes, that's right. Uh-huh.
Or no?
We are about to do that right now. Yes, go ahead.
Oh, thank you. Sorry.
Okay. So, in scientific notation, how would you write 250?
It is 2.5 multiplied by 10 in the second in the degree of 2.
Good, 10 to the power of
2. Sorry, 10 to the power of 2. 2.5 are multiplied by 10 to the power of 2.
No, good, thank you. What about 0.2?
It is 2 multiplied by 10 in the power of minus 1.
And 0.25?
It is 2.5 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 2.
Good, good. And there are the answers. Good, thank you. And then just one last step, because we will be multiplying numbers that involve a lot of zeros. Remember that then we have the product of 10 different powers. We can add those powers together. So in this example, 50 times 500. Is the same as 5 times 5 multiplied by 10 to the power of 3, since 3 is a summation of 1 and 2, or 25,000. And our final mathematical exercise, how would you write 0.5 times 500? In scientific notation. Now let's see, 0.5 is the same as 5 times 10 to the power of minus 1. 500, as Karina has noted, is 5 times 10 to the power of 2. Now, let us add together the powers 2 minus 1 times 5 squared of 250. So there are the steps now that we will follow for your friend that has a monopoly. First, determine quantity. Second, determine price. Third, determine total revenue and total cost. And then finally, compute profit. There's a difference between revenue and cost. I think that this will take about 5 minutes to calculate. And then people come back together and solve the problem. It's a class. 5 minutes. Thank you.
Professor, excuse me.
Uh-huh.
Could you please show the slide with a problem with a formula, please? Thank you, Professor.
Okay, yeah. And also note that marginal cost is constant in this case. Good. I see that Nirvana has the correct answer to poverty. The problem is to provide and calculate the price. And in the profit calculation, don't forget about cost.
Excuse me, Professor.
Uh-huh.
How to find the total cost? I didn't understand. I found the total revenue, but how to integrate marginal cost? Do we have any constants?
Yes, let me go to the whiteboard.
Okay, thank you.
So, we have the marginal cost is equal to $1. Since it is constant, it is also the average cost. That's known as marginal cost. So total cost is the same as average cost times the scale of production. So that is simply 1 times Q. That is total cost.
Professor,
go ahead.
Sorry, when we integrate marginal cost into total cost, we need to get any constant. The constant that when we take the derivative of it, the constant in it disappears. It does not. It is not included in the marginal cost. So how do you know there isn't any constant for marginal, for total cost?
Yes, no, that's a good question. This is a definite integral. In other words, we can specify values at the lower bound and the upper bound. So if I'm using S as an integral sign, we will integrate from 0 to Q, which I think you found 2.5 times 10 to the 6.
Oh, thank you, Professor. Now I understand. Thank you.
Now, beneath the integration is marginal cost. Marginal cost is 1 times dq. So you can handle the problem that way. Solving the integration gives us 2.5 times 10 to the power 6, or just q.
Professor, I estimated the profit, the total profit. Could you check if my Rand's answer is correct in the chat? I found the quantity, total revenue, and the profit.
You're on the right track. You may want to think a bit more about the power of 10 that applies here.
Okay, you mean power of 10 in the total revenue, right?
Profit is total revenue minus total cost.
Yes. Oh, sorry, Professor. It is 1.25 multiplied by 10 in the power of 8. I wrote it by mistake, sorry.
Uh-huh.
It is, yes, I will rewrite. Thank you.
Okay. So let's go back to the calculations to take care of any other questions of the people they have. So yes, Mirabai has shown the determinant property by equating marginal revenue to marginal cost. Remember that since our demand function is linear, the inverse demand function, that is, it is expressed in terms of the price, marginal revenue has the same vertical intercept, but a slope that is twice as steep. So here is our inverse demand function. Marginal value has the same intercept, minus not 2, but 4 times of 1 over 1 times the delta. And then marginal cost is simple. So all that we need to do is to solve the equation for two. Here is marginal cost and here is marginal revenue. The only trick is that the equation is just a little bit messy because of the term 10 to the minus 5. So on the right hand side, we have 101 minus 1 or 100 divided by the coefficient on the left hand side. But 100 over 4 is just 25. And given the 10 in the denominator of 10 to the minus 5, all that we have to do is to multiply through the 10 to the power of 5. And there is a quantity. To get the price, use the inverse demand function. And plug in the solution for quantity right here. And then be just a little bit careful of handling the notations. 10 to the power 6 times 10 to the power minus 5 is just 10. So in the final step, we have 101 minus 5 times 10 or 50. 101 minus 50 gives us a price of 51. And then there are profits. Total revenue is price times quantity. But you already have that information, you have already solved that problem. And then for football costs, this is the same as the level of property, because every unit costs $1 to produce. And then finally, service profit and service cost. And the difference is $125 million. Or as Mirabai says, you could express it as 1.25 times 10 to the power 8.